Well, races begin in a lot of different ways. When I was growing up, one of the things that my parents would do would be to bring us down to Wall Stadium. If you're not familiar with Wall Stadium, it's down in Monmouth County. It's a stock car racetrack. Many of you been there? I don't know if you've, yeah, just a couple. But it's a great experience, especially for a little kid like me, because it's very colorful. All the cars are painted different colors, and it's very loud. The roar of the engines is really stunning. And when the race begins, the cars will go around the track very slowly. And as they come around the final turn and the final straightaway, the starter is on a platform just raised above the track, and he's holding a green flag in his hand. And as those cars come around the corner, if they're all in the right formation, he jumps up and starts waving the flag, and the cars thunder down the straightaway, and it's just really loud and just really a lot of fun, very exciting, especially, like I said, if you're a little kid. But you compare that to the start of, say, an Olympic race, a 100-meter dash, and there it's completely different. All the runners are just standing still. They're in their lanes. And then, the starter says, runners, take your mark, and they get down, and then there's a pause. It's quiet. You don't know when it's coming. And then all of a sudden, bang, the gun, and then they start running. So races begin in different ways. But this morning, I want to talk about a race that is not the competitive kind. Not all races are competitive. I want to talk about a race that had a different beginning. I want to talk about the Jewish race this morning. It did not begin with the wave of a flag or the sound of a gun, but it began with a covenant. God chose one man who we know as Abraham. And that all of Abraham's descendants to be his chosen people. And in the Bible, his chosen people are called by a variety of names. They're referred to as the Jews, the Israelites, the Hebrews. All those are used interchangeably to refer to God's special people. And today I want to look at how God established this special people for himself. So I'd like to look at Genesis 15, and we'll start with verse 1. We read this, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. So we read of Abram, and just to avoid confusion, we hear the name Abraham, and here we read Abram. And Abram was his original name. Abram means exalted father. And a couple chapters later, the Lord is going to change Abram's name to Abraham, which means father of many. And as we see in our text this morning, he will become the father of many. As I go through, I'll refer to Abram, but you might hear an Abraham slip out since I'm so used to saying Abraham, so you'll forgive me if I do that. God begins speaking to Abram, and he begins speaking in terms of his relationship with Abram, because God is very concerned about relationships and how he has a relationship with his people. And so the first thing he says is, fear not. Don't be afraid. Fear is not to characterize God's relationship with Abram, because God is not there to harm him. Just the opposite, as we will see. And he says, I am your shield. God is Abram's shield or protection. In the chapter just before this, in chapter 14, we read about Abram's private army of 318 soldiers, and they were quite skilled fighters, and they had a number of victories in the battles that they had fought. But God is telling Abram, it's not your private army who is your shield and your protection, it's me. It's me. I am going to be the one to protect you in this very dangerous world. And then he says, your reward shall be very great. God is going to reward Abram in some way. Well, we read that in verse 2 and 3. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. See, Abram understood God's promise of reward to be one of a child or of children. To that point in his life, Abram did not have any children. But in ancient times, it was very common to think of children as a reward from God. In fact, in Psalm 127, we read this, children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. So at this late point in his life, Abram was actually more than 75 years old. And he was childless, and so it looked like his estate would, you know, pass along to one of his slaves, actually. And he was not happy about that. So the best reward that Abram could have would be an heir to carry on his estate and his family name. In those times, it was considered so important to have an heir to carry on the family name that if you didn't have children, some people believed that you had been cursed by God because your family name was going to die out. So Abram is basically saying, Lord, if you're going to reward me, please let it be a child. That would be the best thing you could do for me. So we go on in verses 4 and 5. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. And he took him outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. And then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. So the Lord tells Abram directly that he is going to have a child, his own child, who will inherit his estate. But that's only the tip of the iceberg. Abram's offspring will be as countless as the stars in the sky. Now remember, the sky in Abram's day was much darker than it is for us, and you could see a whole lot more stars than we can see here in New Jersey. On a clear night, I go outside my house to walk my dog, and I can look up and I can see maybe 12 or 13 stars, you know, something on that order. But in Abram's time, the night was so dark that the stars just absolutely filled the sky. Thousands and thousands and thousands of stars, and you could never, ever actually count them. So this is a really huge promise. You know, here's Abram, he's over 75 years old, doesn't have any children, and God says, not only are you going to have a child, but you're going to have descendants that are going to be, you know, as numerous as that you can't even count. Such a promise seems so unlikely. It seemed so huge that you wonder, you know, did Abram have that kind of faith to believe in something like that? Well, the next verse tells us how Abram looked at it. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited to him as righteousness. Abram's response was to believe in what God had told him. And this verse also tells us how God then responded to that faith. God credited to Abram as righteousness. Abram was considered righteous, even though he hadn't actually done anything. He was considered righteous, not based on works, but based on his faith. And the same is true for us today. In fact, in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul helps us understand the example of Abram, or Abraham, as Paul would refer to him. In Romans 4, we read this, against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words "it was credited to him" were not written for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. So Abram is our example that righteousness in God's eyes is not so much based on what you do, but it's based on the faith that we have in Jesus Christ. Well, then in verse 7, he also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. This is not the first time that God had appeared to or spoken to Abraham or Abram. Earlier, God had spoken to him and told him that he was to leave his hometown and travel to the land of Canaan. And we learn in the Bible from Acts 7, we read this. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham while he was still in Mesopotamia before he lived in Haran. Leave your country and your people, God said, and go to the land I will show you. So he left the land of the Chaldeans and settled in Haran. And then in Genesis 12, it picks up from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, who would later become Sarah, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they'd accumulated and the people they'd acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. So that could be a little confusing. So what I want to do is just show you on a map what he was asked to do. This is I like this map because it shows the modern countries, and many modern cities, but also has ancient cities listed on the map. And I want to draw your attention to the lower right-hand corner where you see the Persian Gulf. This is, we hear about that a lot in the news today, this area. This little area here is the country of Kuwait. It's not labeled. But here's the Iraqi-Kuwait border, and that's where the Gulf War began in 1990. And we've been engaged in conflict in this area ever since. But not far from where that conflict began, you see here is the city of Ur. That is the ancient city in what is today southern Iraq. And that is the city where Abram lived and grew up. And so the Lord says to Abram, go from Ur here, and I want you to go to the land of Canaan. That's over here, which is today the country of Israel. Now, that was the land of Canaan. And that was the destination. Now, if you go to geometry, you know that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, right? And so if you want to go from Ur to Canaan, what would you do? You go straight across. Well, that's not such a good idea, because all of the land in between here is just desert. And that would be very difficult to cross in those days. You might not survive that. So the path that he takes is to go from Ur and up the Euphrates to this city right here, Haran. And he stays in Haran. He lived there for some time. We don't know for how long. But then from Haran, he sets out and then comes down to the land of Canaan. So let me just show you on another map that might be kind of shows this same area of the world, but shows his trip from Ur to Haran and then back down to Canaan. Now, in terms of miles, that's not a short trip. That's about a 1,000-mile journey to go like that. 1,000 miles. It's a long way to go. 1,000 miles is approximately the distance from here in Piscataway to Montgomery, Alabama. I used to live in Montgomery. I miss it a little bit. For me to come from Montgomery up to here, or for us to go down there, we get on a plane and we're down there in a couple hours. It's not that big a deal. But if you had to walk it, I mean, that would take a really long time. If I had to walk it, I would probably get about as far as New Brunswick, and that would be the end for me. I would just say, this is not for me. So Abram has to make this incredible journey on foot. You can just imagine how long and how much faith it would have required for him to obey the Lord and proceed on this journey. But he does. So the Lord tells him, again, just in verse 7, he says, I'm the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land and to do what? To take possession of it. You see, Abram is not only to go to the land of Canaan, but he's to go there and own it. He's going there to possess it. It's going to become his. Well, Abram responds, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? He's asking the Lord how he knows that this is going to happen. Now, Abram is not doubting God. We're just told in verse 6 that he believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness, right? So what Abraham is doing here is asking for a sign or something to symbolize the promise. He had just been given that as far as his descendants go. What did the Lord do? He said, you're going to have many descendants. Go out and look at the sky. The stars in the sky were his sign of the promise, his sign that he would have many descendants. And he's asking for the same thing here. Give me a sign, Lord, that I will have the land. Kind of in the same way that God did with Noah. You remember when Noah, after the flood, came out of the ark, and the Lord promised Noah he would never flood the entire earth again like that. And what was the sign he gave Noah? The rainbow in the sky. And so Abram is looking for a sign, and God is going to give Abram a sign. The sign that God is going to give Abram is to establish a covenant with him. We hear this word covenant a lot, but what exactly is a covenant? Well, covenants were very, very common in the ancient world. It was basically an agreement between individuals or even between groups or nations. So in the Bible is no exception. Just like in the ancient world, the Bible, we see covenants. And sometimes the covenants in the Bible are made between individuals. Sometimes they're made between God and persons, and sometimes between God and groups of people. So a covenant basically spelled out the nature of your relationship. One example would be if one king in the ancient world conquered another king, and now they're going to establish a covenant actually spell out the nature of their relationship. The defeated king maybe has to pay tribute. His authority is only going to be in this area. And the victorious king says, well, you're going to pay me this, and you're going to let my soldiers, you know, be stationed. Whatever their arrangements were. And then it would also include what they called curses. And curses would basically be, here's what's going to happen to you if you fail to live up to the end of your bargain. And usually that would be some sort of punishment. So that was a covenant, and I guess probably the modern-day equivalent for us would be a contract. We all enter into contracts. If you hire someone to come and paint your house, right, you would normally have a contract, and the painter would indicate on the contract the rooms that you want painted. You know, I'm going to paint the living room, the kitchen, and the dining room, and here's what the cost is going to be. And then your part of the bargain is to pay that cost once it's completed. So you have this contract that spells out the nature of your relationship. But there was actually a little bit more to a covenant. A covenant usually, not always, but usually involved an oath. And, you know, that people would swear to abide by the contract. And we don't use oaths in our everyday life so much, but we do use them in court. You know, in a court of law, when you take an oath, you better tell the truth, because there are some serious consequences if you commit perjury under oath, right? You have to tell the truth. Oaths were a very important part of the covenant. But the covenant then had to be, once it was written, it had to be ratified. Let me show you an example. This is kind of interesting. Of a covenant that they found. Archaeologists discovered this covenant. And I took the caption. It says, an example of a mutual obligation covenant dating from 672 BC between Assyria and one of its vassal kings, and it ends with Assyria curses. So this is something that was happening all over the ancient world, and here the conquering king sets up this covenant, and the curses are, hey, here's what's going to happen to you, little king, if you don't do what I say, and probably very unpleasant things would occur. Contract, our covenant, is very, very similar. And just like one another, they have to be ratified. Covenants had to be ratified, just like our contracts. How do you ratify a covenant? Well, our contracts are ratified by, how do you ratify a contract? You sign your name at the bottom. What does that do? That makes the contract official, okay? It's now in force. It's now been ratified. And covenants were the same way, except they didn't sign their names. What they would do would be either take an oath that would ratify, or sometimes a common way was by sacrificing an animal. And the blood of the animal was ratifying that covenant. Now, what they would do a lot of times is take the animal and actually cut the animal in half. I know that sounds a little gruesome. Believe me, it would be far more gruesome to actually see it happen, and far more gruesome to actually have to do it. But this is what they did, and they would take the animal and separate the two halves. And then each of the parties in the covenant would then walk between the two halves of the animal. And what they were in effect saying was that, may what happened to this animal happen to me if I violate the terms of this covenant. And that's how serious covenants were. Far more serious than the contracts that we have today. In fact, in the Old Testament, whenever you read the phrase made a covenant, the Hebrew word for made actually means to cut. And so in Hebrew, they don't say make a covenant. In Hebrew, they say cut a covenant. And the cutting is a reference to cutting the animals in half to show how serious the covenant actually is. We have an example in the Bible where some people made a covenant with God and did not live up to it. And we see God's attitude towards those who do not live up to the covenant. We read this in Jeremiah 34, beginning at verse 18. The Lord is speaking, and he says, those who have violated my covenant and have not fulfilled the terms of the covenant they made before me, I will treat like the calf they cut in two and then walk between its pieces. The leaders of Judah and Jerusalem, the court officials, the priests, and all the people of the land who walk between the pieces of the calf, I will deliver into the hands of their enemies who want to kill them. Their dead bodies will become food for the birds and the wild animals. It's an ominous, very ominous sense there that when you make a covenant, especially with God, God takes it very seriously. Well, we go on in Genesis 9. So the Lord is going to make a covenant with Abram as a sign that he will gain possession of the land. So the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. So God tells Abram to bring five types of animals. And we're not exactly told why, but it will turn out that years later, when God establishes his covenant with Moses and the Jewish people, that these are the five animals that are used for will be used for sacrifice. So maybe there's a connection there of some sort, but we're not exactly sure. But those are the five animals that God wants Abram to bring. So what does he do? Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. And then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. So here Abram cuts the animals in half, as he was told to do. But the birds he doesn't. And again, we're not told why. But we do know that later, with the covenant that God had with Moses, birds were not cut in half. They were put on the altar without being cut in half. Again, we don't exactly know why, we're not told, but maybe it has to do with that. But he takes the other animals and separates them in half and lays them out, just like you would do in a covenant. But then we have this interesting comment that birds of prey came down and began to go for the animal carcasses, and Abram had to drive them away. What's the significance of that? Well, I think the significance is a symbolic one, and we'll see it in the next two verses. So we read in 12 and 13. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. And then the Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. Well, Abram falls into this deep sleep, and it says a dreadful and thick darkness falls upon him. And I think the dreadful and thick darkness sets the stage for the very gloomy prophecy that is about to come regarding Abram's descendants. They're going to be enslaved and mistreated and afflicted for 400 years. Now, we know from looking back at history that that refers to the time that the Israelites spent in slavery in Egypt. Okay? And I think that's what the birds of prey in verse 11 is referring to. Just like his descendants would be oppressed by the Egyptians, Abram is being oppressed by the birds of prey, coming to try and steal his sacrifice, and he had to fight them off, and then was successful. And in the same way, his descendants would be oppressed by Egypt, and then would be able to get away finally in the end. But we go on then in verse 14, and the Lord says, I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. And you remember the story of how those Israelites got out of Egypt. You remember? They were enslaved for Egypt, and then God comes to Moses and says, go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Right? And so Moses went up to Pharaoh and said, hey, we're leaving. And Pharaoh says, I don't think so. And so there was this conflict, right? And so then what did the Lord do to help Pharaoh make the right decision is he brought a series of plagues onto Egypt. And these plagues were really nasty, like flies, you know, flies you couldn't get away from, frogs coming all over the place. You know, it was very, very harsh plagues that came upon the people. And I believe that's what the judgment that God is talking about, I'll bring judgment on that country. And that came in the form of those plagues. But when the Israelites did leave, the Lord says they'll come out with many great possessions. And, you know, that's exactly what happened. In Exodus 12, we read this. The Israelites did as Moses instructed and asked the Egyptians for articles of silver and gold and for clothing. The Lord had made the Egyptians favorably disposed to the people, and they gave them what they asked for, and so they plundered the Egyptians. So this is kind of interesting, because if you put yourself in that position, here you have these Egyptians suffering these plagues, these horrible plagues, and they realized that, you know, if the Israelites would just leave, you know, the plagues would stop. And so I think the attitude on the Egyptians was, look, just anything you want, just take it and go, you know, if it'll get rid of you. And so I think the Israelites said, okay, yeah, we'll need gold and we'll need silver and some clothing for the trip. If you could. And fine, you know, take it and go. And I think that was the attitude. And so they literally were able to go with all of these possessions that that they would not have ordinarily had. And so they left Egypt. Well, then we continue on, and the Lord says to Abram in verse 15, "You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age." And so finally, here's some good news for Abram. Right? God tells him he's going to live to be really old. And in fact, in Genesis 25, we're told Abraham lived 175 years. And then Abraham breathed his last and died at a good old age. 175. That's getting up there, I got to tell you. That is old. And one of the things about getting old that I know I've noticed in my life, and people who are older often tell me, is that your memory begins to get a little bit shaky the older you get. I know even now I have problems sometimes remembering people's names or small details of things. People do tend to lose their memory a little bit, but there is kind of a humorous side to losing your memory. It's kind of like the story that I came across of three elderly sisters who lived together. One was 92, one was 94, and one was 96. And one night they're sitting down at the kitchen table, and the 92-year-old says, or excuse me, the oldest one, the 96-year-old says, "I'm going to go upstairs and take a bath." So she goes upstairs and runs the bath water, and as she's about to step into the tub, she yells downstairs, "Was I getting in the tub or was I getting out?" So her 94-year-old sister yells, "Well, I don't know, let me come up and help you." And she goes over to the stairs to go upstairs, she goes up one step and she yells out, "Was I going up the stairs or was I coming down?" Meanwhile, the 92-year-old sitting at the kitchen table, she's hearing all this, and she thinks to herself, "Man, I hope my memory never gets that bad, knock on wood." She yells out, "I'll come up and help you as soon as I see who's at the door." So I hope Abram's memory never got that bad as he got to be 175. Well, we go on in verse 16, and the Lord says this, "In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure." Having reassured Abram of his own long life and his own safety, the Lord now returns to the subject of his descendants. And he says that after four generations, his descendants, the Israelites, would leave Egypt and return to the promised land. Now, the Hebrew word here for generation it's a very vague term. It doesn't have a set number of years attached to it in Hebrew. And so here it's used in a figurative way and probably represents a generation measured according to Abram's own situation. When Abram had his first son Isaac, do you know how old he was? 100. He was 100 years old when Isaac was born. And so here a generation is probably referring to roughly 100 years. And so the Lord is saying that after four generations, or roughly 400 years, the Israelites would come out of Egypt, and that matches what was said earlier about the 400 years in captivity. And the reason why, 400 years is a long time, the reason why is given here in this verse. It has to do with the Amorites. The Amorites were a very, very evil people. And sometimes the word Amorites didn't only refer to them, but it was kind of a catch-all for all of the people who lived in the land of Canaan. And these people as a whole were incredibly evil. They were wicked and cruel beyond description. And what's going on here is that God says he's going to bring judgment upon that people. But the Lord says he's going to wait until the sin has reached its full measure. In other words, God is not going to judge people until they deserve it, until the sin is full and they're going to deserve what God is going to do to them in terms of punishment. God will be fully justified because when he brings judgment, it is always fair and it is always deserved. Well, then in verses 17 and 18, "When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces." That would be the pieces of the animal that Abram had separated. "On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, 'To your descendants, I give this land.'" So here the smoking firepot and the flaming torch represent the presence of God. And in Scripture, we see God's presence is often seen in terms of fire. You remember the Lord appeared to Moses for the first time in what? A burning bush. And when the Israelites did come out of Egypt, they followed the pillar of fire at night, which represented God's presence as they wandered in the desert. And then you remember at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit appeared as tongues of fire above the disciples. And so here the fiery presence of the Lord comes and passes between the animals that Abram had cut in two. And in this way, the Lord cuts a covenant with Abram. And what's worth noting here is that only God passes through the animals. You'll notice that Abram did not. So this was a very particular kind of covenant. It was a unilateral covenant. In this case, it involved the land that Abram's offspring would inherit, and it would become the land that we know today as Israel. That's going to be what he's going to have. And the promise that that is going to happen did not involve any action on Abram's part. He didn't have to do anything. He didn't have any obligation. This is just something God said he was going to do, and he was creating this covenant to confirm it with Abram. It was the sign that Abram was looking for. And this, the description of that land follows next. From the Wadi of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates. So here the Lord gives some boundaries as to what this promised land is going to include. And the two rivers that he mentions kind of form a northern and a southern border for the promised land. And let me just kind of show you on this map what we're talking about here. This is the land of Canaan, or today what would be Israel. And this right here would be the Wadi, or the river of Egypt that's being referred to. And in those days, that was considered the southern border, generally, of the land of Canaan. And then he also talks about the great river Euphrates. Now, the northern part of the Euphrates is right up here. So you can see it kind of forms a northern and a southern border to this area in between, which was the promised land. And again, that's the area that we know today as the country of Israel. God has made this covenant with Abram. He makes covenants with his people. God relates to us through covenants. God established not only this covenant with Abraham, he established a covenant with Noah, a covenant with David, and of course the most famous one with Moses that involved the entire Jewish people. And that's the one that we usually refer to when we talk about the Jewish law or the Old Testament law. It includes the entire first five books of the Bible, Genesis through Deuteronomy, and there you read all of the rules and the regulations that the ancient Jews had to follow in order to relate to God. That is how God wanted them to relate to him, was by following all of these laws. So what about today? What about today? Do we need to follow those Old Testament laws? They are part of our Bible, right? We say we have the Bible, we obey the Bible. Do we have to obey all of those rules and regulations? Well, you know the answer is no, because we don't make sacrifices and we don't do those kind of things anymore. The answer is no. The reason why is because when Jesus came, he fulfilled the entire law on our behalf. You know, lots of times when we think of Jesus, we think, well, he came to die on our behalf. He died on the cross for our sins. And that's only part of the story. He also came to live on our behalf. He lived a perfect life, perfectly fulfilled the Jewish law, did everything absolutely correctly for us. And since he did that for us, we are now free from that obligation. That obligation is no longer part of what our relationship with God is about. But if God does relate to his people through covenants, are we involved with some kind of covenant today with the Lord? Well, the answer is yes, we are. On the night before Jesus was crucified, he spoke of this new covenant in words that are familiar to you. We say these each time we have communion, but in Luke 22:20, we read this. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." The new covenant. The new covenant was established by Jesus and ratified by his blood. It was not the death of sacrificial animals, but the death of Jesus that confirmed or ratified our new covenant with God. Now, what are the obligations of this covenant? Well, God's part of the covenant would be to send his son to die on the cross, to forgive us our sins, and then to provide us with eternal life in his presence. That's God's part. What's our part? Well, our part is to have faith in Jesus and to trust him as our personal Savior. And having done that, then to walk in ways that are pleasing to him. Our lives should be all about pleasing Jesus in every way. This is something we need to be aware of each day. Every day we should be asking ourselves, how am I going to please Jesus today? Are you consciously trying to obey what he has commanded on a daily basis? Is that part of the way you think? Are you actively seeking opportunities to serve him? I would encourage you, look for where there's a need and volunteer. Volunteer. Become active in your service to the Lord. Live a lifestyle that conforms to biblical principles. Don't follow the world. Let the Bible be your guideline in terms of how you live your life. Worship the Lord. Study his word seriously and pray often. These are the kinds of things that we are to do to uphold our part of the new covenant. Let me close with these very instructive words from the Apostle Paul, where he describes what new covenant people should look like. He writes this in Romans 12. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need and practice hospitality. If these are the kinds of things you can do, then you will be walking according to the covenant that Jesus gave his life for. And when you do, he will be pleased. Let's pray.